You're muted, Mark.
Yes, that would help. Hello, welcome to the Cool Kids Live review of Avatar: The Way of Water. I am KitchenAid Whiskey Jones. To my right or left, whatever the hell it is the right dude. To his right or left, whatever, again, is next to him is the Geek Informant. Below him is the world's biggest geek. And last but not least, right below me is Cinematic Sterling. And today we are, of course, reviewing Avatar: The Way of Water. We'll just get right into it. You know the format. If you've seen this before, I will go first, then right dude, then the Geek Informant, then the world's biggest geek, and finally, Cinematic, last but not least, Cinematic Sterling. So I'll start off myself. So as someone who enjoyed the first movie, I never understood the hate. I get it not being one's cup of tea, but the jokes were way over the top. Fern Gully with blue people, Dances with blue people, Pocahontas with blue people, the Smurfs saved the world, etc. It's like people couldn't keep their story straight, were more interested in making jokes than serious analysis. Sure, the story was rather basic, but the characters were decent, the acting was solid, and the visuals were absolutely stunning. It was the only 3D movie I have ever seen that was worth the extra price of admission. Or it was until last night. I expected more of the same, and while it was a continuation of the story, I found this one to be even better. The visuals were as stunning and gorgeous as one would expect, perhaps even more so, with Cameron taking full advantage of the aquatic setting. The action was as thrilling and exciting as the first, with some added tension as his kids constantly found themselves in danger. The story is more engrossing, with Stephen Lang returning as Colonel Quaritch, this time in the body of an avatar, in an old-fashioned tale of revenge. However, what elevates this film over the first is the emotional depth provided by the strong dynamics of the Sully family. This time, Sam Worthington's Jake Sully isn't just fighting the abstract idea of colonialism, but also to protect his very real blended family with Zoe Saldana's Neytiri, including three beautiful kids of their own. Kiri, the adopted miracle daughter of Sigourney Weaver's Grace, from last film, also voiced by her, and the orphaned human son of Colonel Quaritch, affectionately known as Spider. It is the kids that draw you into the story and keep you interested throughout, even when it does admittedly lag at times. The film earnestly takes its time to develop these new characters, though, making you care about them and their fate. Thus, it is understandable if some of the characters from the last one feel a bit sidelined. This is what elevates it above the first film. I should also add that another element that elevates it above the first film was the element of the whales, the Tokun, I believe they're called, and who were just absolutely beautiful and very well handled, very intelligent creatures, and I felt very emotionally connected to them as well. At the end of the day, if you like the first film, you will like this one. If you didn't like the last one, if you didn't like the first one, you probably won't like this one either. Just try not to have an apoplectic fit about it. Thus, my rating is an 8.5 out of 10. All right. And next is the right dude.
Awesome. Okay. Well, let me just state that I thought the first film was average. I don't think it's a bad movie, but I'd be lying if I said I didn't get it, a lot of the hate for some people. So when it was announced that James Cameron would be making a sequel to his highest grossing film of all time, I was a little skeptical, but hopeful that he would at least improve the criticisms that people had with the first film. After seeing it, I will say Cameron did do his homework and improve some things with the first one. It's not great, but I will take it over the first one. Let's just get the obvious things out of the way. Just like the first ones, the visuals look gorgeous. The best scenes are the underwater scenes and the moments where the characters are surfing along the creature characters. The world of Pandora never looks so beautiful. The world of Pandora looks like a place you wouldn't actually mind visiting. The 3D was also amazing. I usually don't like 3D just in general and just consider just nothing but a cheap gimmick, but Avatar, the first one and this one, is the rare exception where that is not the case. The cinematography, camera angles are also well done. The acting, for the most part, is solid. Most of the actors bring their A game to their roles. Only exception is Sam Worthington, which I just am still not really much of a fan of. I mean, he didn't do bad or anything, but I just didn't think he did as great of a job as the rest. The action scenes were awesome to witness, and I was on the edge of my seat throughout the third act. And unlike the first one, I actually did care more about the characters in this one. Especially the bonding relationship between Sully and his family, and mainly the kids. They were really the heart of the movie, just like with Mark, they were the heart of the movie for me. Especially liked how one of them was more of an adopted daughter, or who was like the biological daughter of Grace, Sigourney Weaver's character from the first one, who died, spoiler alert. However, it's one of the, but one that I really enjoyed was the character Loka, who was like the youngest of son, who was trying to live up to his father's standards. And I just like how he just becomes a strong warrior at the end. I mean, yes, he does a lot of, he does become a little reckless here and there, but I do appreciate the trying arc he was going through. And as I said, the family dynamics were just a strong point in this film for me. I do have issues with it. I'm not saying, like I said, it's not great. It's not perfect. There are moments that were a little too predictable. It wasn't as predictable as the first one, though. I'll give it that. But I felt like they could have made it a little bit better, made it a little, you didn't know where the story was going. And I also thought the pacing could have been a little bit better. Some moments could have been cut down a little bit just to make the narrative feel a little smoother. And I mean, there's also maybe some generic tropes here and there, like the bullies, which I'm sick of, but thankfully this trope wasn't on screen for very long. So, I mean, it just wasn't too big a problem. Overall though, I did have a good time. I did have a good watch with this movie. It's not perfect, but I will say it is a step up from the first one. If James Cameron learns from the criticisms from the previous films and improves on them in sequels, maybe we might get something great, but only time will tell for that. If you joined the first one, and I'm pretty sure you will really like the second one. If you weren't, then I'd still say at least give it a chance. You may be surprised. And my overall rating is a 7 out of 10.
All right. Okay. And John, you're up. Oh, sorry. Wow. Sorry, John.
Just
your turn, my opinion
before I even get to fucking review. You asshole. Anyway.
Hold up.
You don't get it. I built this place. Down here, I make the rules. Down here, I make the threats.
Okay, sure. Anyway.
You may go now.
Clichés, tropes, and metaphors. Oh my. It should be unsurprising that this is another lackluster entry in the Avatar franchise. While not bad or as passionless like some other franchises going on right now, it still executes its ideas rather poorly. The performances are all pretty good. Stephen Lang and Cliff Curtis are the notable standouts as Quaritch and Tanawari, although the younger cast do a surprisingly good job as well, with the best, in my personal opinion, being Jack Champion as Spider. Sam Worthington returns as Jake Sully, and he's still pretty dull. He's not exactly the best actor, and as I said, is pretty dull for most of the film. In terms of other returning actors, we have Zoe Saldana as Neytiri, CCH Pounder as Mowat, Sigourney Weaver as this time her own offspring Kiri, and even Giovanni Ribisi as Selfridge in a cameo. All are pretty good. Sopranos alum Edie Falco joins the cast as General Ardmore, as well as Kate Winslet as the Chief's wife, Ronal, and Jemaine Clement as Dr. Gavin. All three were, again, pretty damn good. When it comes to performances, all do a good job. It's just that the main flaws when it comes to these characters are not the performances, but the characters themselves, with being paper-thin caricatures who are pretty poorly developed. Jake is the tough dad trying to hold this family together, Neytiri being the supportive wife, Netayam is the oldest son who's supposedly perfect at everything he does, while Lawak is the troublemaker rebel who nobody understands and is an outcast. Kiri is a Jesus metaphor, because why not? While Took is just child who is in danger sometimes. You also have the one-dimensional bullies, everyone's favorite trope, and the one-dimensional big bad military villains. It's just very eye-rolling, but I came to expect it, so no skin off my nose. Despite this, it's a fucking visual masterpiece. I never would have doubted that from Cameron. Every penny was spent properly, perfectly showcasing the world of Pandora, although different from the first film. There were a couple shots that were a bit off, but it was because both involved humans rather than Na'vi. But outside of that, yes, the effects and world are still as brilliant as the first film, but now even better with 13 years of technological advancements. The plot was fine, however, it was the most interesting in the first and third acts, the setup and the payoff. Good stuff and either interesting or enjoyable. But while there are good bits of the second act, it does suffer from massive pacing issues. You definitely feel the 3 hours at a certain point. I was pretty much checking my watch in the second half of the film. There's a lot of random shots of just characters taking in the world, and at a point it feels like filler. I get what Cameron was doing with his world building, but even my dad at a certain point was like, all right, let's get fucking on with it, and he's more forgiving of this than I am. As I said in my opening statement, this is filled to the brim with overused cliches and tropes. As I stated, many of the kids are just that, one-dimensional cliches, like Lawak being the outcast nobody understands except for this giant sea monster thing. So James Cameron is apparently ripping off fucking Free Willy now. Then on top of that, you have the one-dimensional bullies that come to an understanding with our protagonist by taking the blame for something that the one-dimensional bully actually did. Then you have Kiri being this fucking Jesus metaphor because she was apparently a fucking virgin birth from Grace's avatar. Yeah, because that worked so fucking well in Phantom Menace. As well as doing other things that people can't, like being in control of the animals and all that shit. God, I just know that they're going to make her this overly important character in the fucking sequels. Then, on top of that, you still have the evil white man killing the indigenous peoples because reasons, carrying over from the first movie, while also adding in a Vietnam War metaphor in there as well. Then you have a new magic MacGuffin, this time from unobtainium in the first film to the magical apple juice from the sea monsters that stops aging, apparently. Can't wait for that to also become overly important in the sequels. Even though the performances and visual effects are extremely impressive, as well as the world building, the on-the-nose metaphors, overused cliches and tropes, pacing, and ripping off other movies prevents this from being the greatness that Cameron wants this to be. There is a lot of passion on his part, which is why I can't in good conscience give this a terrible rating. It is a major step up from what something like Marvel is doing currently, or the complete and utter shitstorm that DC is as well. I give this points that Cameron is trying to do a blockbuster that isn't yet another cape shit film, but it's just that it's very poorly executed with its plot, characters, and themes. And with that, I give it a 6.5 out of 10.
Jay, you're next.
All right, so I didn't prepare a script for this, like, off the film. I remember when I was six, I remember watching the first Avatar movie. And I remember loving it. And I would watch it all the time. And then years later, I understood, you know, more and more about the criticism towards the movie, even though I never really agreed with it. Yes, is it Pocahontas with blue people? Yes, is it Dancing with Wolves? Yes, but I still think it's a good story, in my personal opinion. There's nothing wrong with taking inspiration from certain ideas from other movies. But in all goodness, I still think that first Avatar is an amazing film, and it's definitely worthy of it being the highest grossing film of all time, even though they kind of cheated. But going into this movie, I expected this movie to be great. I had expectations because I myself was one of the few who were really excited for the sequel when it was announced many, many years ago. And I always wondered when the sequel was going to come out. And when it finally came around, I was very excited for this movie. So going into this movie, I will say that I have mixed feelings about this movie. To talk about the positive, the CGI is great. I think the CGI was great. As far as characters, I feel like it's hit or miss with me with the characters. I think Jake was good at certain areas, but he definitely was lacking at certain in other areas as well. I feel like Natiri was very underused for the majority of the film and twisted until the end of, until the final battle. I think the kids were fine, but sometimes, you know, it's, especially with his second son, he definitely, while he was definitely receiving the short end of the stick, it was also warranted considering he caused a lot of trouble, most of the trouble for the entire film, except for like the one scene, except for the one time where he stumbled across the whale. And as far as Kiri, I liked Kiri, I really did, but I wish that this movie would have told us, why does she have these powers? Why does she have this connection to AWA? Is it because Grace died and she connected with AWA? Is it because of her avatar? Like, why is she? I wish this movie explained to me, why does Kiri have these gifts? Like, why? And as far as their youngest kid took, I mean, for as far as like a child, you know, being in the movie, I mean, she wasn't that terrible. Korich, I think Korich was definitely a villain that should have stayed dead in the first movie, because in this movie, I felt like he was definitely not as great as he was in the first film. I think we should have had focused on the general who I thought was going to be the villain in the third movie, but turns out Korich is going to be alive and he's going to be active in the next couple of sequels. And as far as now the negatives, I really feel like this movie was kind of just a carbon copy of the first one in certain areas. Like, for example, we have another MacGuffin that makes a lot of money that the rich and army that the sky people want. We have a character who gets shot off screen or who gets shot and dies when we don't see them getting shot. Again, Jake Sully learning the ways of another tribe and learning their customs and everything. The ending is kind of similar is very similar to the first movie. We have a scene that kind of is played for dramatic effect and sadness with the whale dying and the home tree being destroyed, and they have the same music cue. And it's just, I feel like this movie was not what I wanted. Although it is a solid film in certain areas, I still think this movie has a lot of problems. And the more that I think about it, the more I start to realize that this movie was not that amazing. So as an Avatar supporter, I will say I was left pretty disappointed with what I got. And my score, my score was a 7 out of 10. But now that I'm saying my thoughts out loud more, I'm going to have to knock it down 5 points by a half point and give it a 6.5 out of 10.
Thanks a lot for that.
Wah, wah, wah.
Thanks a lot for totally fucking up my rating system. Jesus. Your turn. Let's hear more superficial criticisms.
All right. So let me start off by saying I am not a fan of the first Avatar. While I acknowledge it holds up visually, the world is interesting, the action scenes are great. The story is way too predictable and generic. The characters are boring and forgettable, and the pacing is awful. So naturally, when James Cameron announced The Wank of Cameron, I mean The Way of Water, I wasn't really excited. However, I wanted to give the man himself a chance. And what did I think? Well, I do think it's better than the first one. I still don't love this movie. Positives first. Wow, this movie is beautiful to look at. Like, it looks so much better. He really improved the effects from the first one, because the first one already looked amazing, but here, wow, it's amazing. Like, this is a movie that is meant for 3D. The water civilization looks absolutely stunning. The action scenes are intense and a lot of fun. The Na'vi get a lot of badass moments here and there, especially during the end of the movie. For the most part, the acting is solid. There are some pretty funny moments in the movie. Like when one of Jake's sons is like, "So here's a trick with my hand. You see this? Like, that had me dying in the theater. That was great. The score is great once again. And while I don't remember their names for the life of me, I was invested in Jake and Neytiri's kids. I surprisingly enjoyed them for the most part. Now on to what I didn't like. After 13 years, I was hoping James would improve on the issues that people had with the first movie, but instead, he gave me more of the same. The generic and predictable story is still here. I could tell what was going to happen and when it was going to happen. They stopped the story in the middle so James could say, "Hey, isn't this scenery beautiful? Isn't this pretty?" Yes, James. It is absolutely beautiful. But you're not giving me a story I care about. So why should I care about the visuals? I mean, I do. But you know what I mean. I still don't think the characters are very... A lot of the characters are very memorable or interesting. Hell, I can barely remember half of their names. The only new characters' names I can remember are Took, Spider, and Kiri. The other ones I don't remember. A lot of them just felt like generic tropes, such as generic excited little girl, rebellious teenager, generic bullies, etc. I'm still not a fan of Sam Worthington as Sully. He is not convincing as a leading man. I still don't think he's a good actor, and he still sounds flat with his delivery. He went from having little to no personality in the first movie to being a complete asshole, especially with his second son. Yes, the son will disobey, but there are moments where he goes way too far with him, and I really didn't like him. It doesn't feel earned when he tells his son, "I see you." It just didn't feel earned, and it felt kind of sudden. And it also doesn't help that Jake makes a lot of really dumb decisions in this movie. Just like how he does in the first one, but here, wow, he has a lot of dumbass moments. I understand you want to protect your family, but Jesus Christ, you need to fucking think clearly. I love Sigourney Weaver, but her playing a teenager came off as really awkward and distracting. I could tell this is a grown woman trying to come off as a teenager, and it just didn't work for me. And also a lot of the whole Jesus metaphors with her and her being like a perfect Mary Sue just didn't really work for me. While I do think the actor who played Spider was really good, he got on my nerves a lot. His character was very inconsistent. At one point, he's on the Na'vi side, and then all of a sudden, he's not. Then he is, and then he's not. Then he is, then he's not. Like, he could never make up his fucking mind. While Stephen Lang is really good as Colonel Quidditch, once again, he's still a one-dimensional villain, but he felt a lot more flat here. Because his whole motive and his ideal is, "I'm evil. I want revenge." And I think it's stupid. He's going to be the main villain for the rest of this franchise. It's like Superman movies, you only using Lex Luthor or General Zod as the villain. And while the action was great, I was not a fan of the 48 frames per second. I didn't like when Hobbit and Unexpected Journey did it, and I don't like it here either. Everything was all sped up, and it kind of looked like a video game. And lastly, this movie is too goddamn long. Way of Water felt every bit of 3 hours, and I wish James used the runtime to develop the story and the characters a little more instead of just stopping to show off how beautiful the visuals are. In conclusion, while I am very critical on the movie, I don't hate it. Outside of the visuals and the acting, I just found this movie to be pretty meh. After 13 years, I expected better than this, and I am not excited for 3 more of these fucking movies. I recommend seeing it for the visuals alone, especially in 3D. And if you're a fan of the first Avatar, you're going to like this one. If you're not, it's probably going to give you more of the same. While I don't love the movie, I will agree this movie is meant to be seen in theaters, and I unfortunately have to give it a 5.5 out of 10. A 5.5 out of 10. There we go. All right, Mark. I'm ready.
Come at us!
Come on! Come on, baby!
You want to get nuts?
Come on!
Let's get nuts.
Oh, don't cry, Mark. It's going to be okay.
You're muted. Dude, you're muted.
Let me need a minute before I go the fuck off.
Oh no. I've seen him angry. Okay, guys, what you guys are about to see is pure rage. If we had recorded the meeting when we found out that Superman was not going to be brought, like, that Henry Cowell wasn't going to, you would have seen what you got, what we are about to witness right now. Because what you are about to witness is.
I'm not going to go that hardcore. I'm going to go easy on you. I will say about some of your criticisms.
What the fuck is this?
Seriously, I mean, come on. I mean,
I don't know.
Look, didn't develop the characters. They were taking the time to develop the kids. I understand, Neytiri and yes, even Jake were shoved aside a bit but that was all in service of developing the kids.
It was more focusing on the kids, yeah.
Okay, but is it really asking a lot for James Cameron to juggle a lot of a roster full of characters? I mean,
there's way too many characters in this movie.
We've seen movies that have had the task of developing and handling a whole bunch of characters, albeit Infinity War or something along those lines. I mean, we've had movies where they have a lot of characters and they do a good job of developing those. So, I mean, is it asking a lot?
But she could have had maybe a few more scenes, but I mean, a little more, but I mean, there's really not much to develop left with her. I mean, it is what it is. So, I mean, with Jake, I mean, I could even understand, he's being an asshole. But at the same time, I understand why he's being an asshole because I'm a parent. Understand, he's trying to protect his kids. His younger son wasn't just fucking up. His younger son was fucking up and putting them all in danger, putting himself in danger. So, he was pretty pissed.
He said,
you've done enough. But at the same time, I understood where it was coming from. He fucked up and got his older brother killed.
Okay, but at the same time, you don't say that when you lost your firstborn. Losing your firstborn is heartbreaking. I understand that, but that's not the right time to say that to someone.
It's not. It's not. But I mean, it's understandable that he would. Go ahead, John.
John's got something to say.
Although it is kind of ironic that Jake was kind of yelling at the troublemaking kid, Loak. A lot of time, you're in danger, all this shit. Da, 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 da. Yet he's the one that called the Indian guy and the nerdy guy and gave away their location. So literally, the second half of the movie is entirely Jake's fault.
Thank you.
Hold on. That was the only reason he did that was trying to save his fucking daughter. Me for crying out loud.
We didn't even need
who was. I don't get that. She didn't even need them anyway.
She's literally almost died there, John.
She's not a Mary Sue.
She was a Mary Sue. Devin said that was a Mary.
I'm just saying, Devin. She was not a Mary Sue. She literally almost fucking died. She had a seizure and almost died for fuck's sake.
Yeah, I don't think she's a Mary Sue.
She's not a Mary Sue.
Jesus!
No, she's not a Mary Sue.
I just like to know why. I don't mind a bit of mystery
about her origins. So clearly, they're going to take their time and develop that, show that in the sequels. But I mean,
But I hated how we have to wait for another movie to learn about the person's origin. It's like it's kind of a whole world to explore here.
But I mean, look, I mean, what sense would it make for a whole world? This isn't Star Wars here, where you have one world that has one people with one culture. That doesn't make any fucking sense. I mean,
you just sound like the Flashmasters from Winter Soldier. One world, one people.
One world with one fucking.
You gotta have at least some mystery, like for sequels. It's like here's the thing. It's like I'm just so fucking sick of the Chosen One bullshit. I'm so fucking sick of it. Like, I get it. It's gonna be around until it'll live longer than all of us combined.
Yeah, it will.
I'm so done, because before this I was working on my upcoming video about the 13th Doctor era and how they essentially made her the Chosen One because Chris Chibnall's a fucking idiot. So I'm just sick of seeing all these fucking characters that are or become Chosen One, and it's like, all right, okay, at least with Dune, there's more to that. I was initially pissed that it was Chosen One stuff, but at least there's some precedent there that it's like almost like a reversal of the Chosen One, or like a
examination of the Chosen One. It shows the
That at least they do something that it didn't show that in the first movie, which is why I was kind of angry with it. But upon researching, there is more. But it sucks how they couldn't show that in the first one anyway. Yeah. But that's beside the point. I'm just sick of the Chosen One. I'm so fucking sick. Like Hero's Journey, fine, whatever. But I'm sick of Chosen One bullshit. Yeah. Like it's
this is the thing.
I mean,
I get.
I know. I can't do anything, but I'm just done with it.
It's like really hope that they're not going the way that I think they're going to be going with this whole like, where does she come from? Because the last time I watched something that handled it like this, they handled it terribly. And we all know what happened.
Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from?
Cotton Eye Joe.
I'm being serious. Like next movie, they need to resolve this whole "where does she come from?" I swear, if this is
I
would assume that they do. I would assume that they do because the next one is called The Seed Bearer, and I assume that's like has something to do with birth.
The Seed Bearer.
It has to be on the nose. James Cameron can't be that fucking stupid.
I'm surprised
like, it's got to be like a birth thing. So I assume the second one is going to focus on Kiri.
Yeah,
I'm surprised the third movie wasn't called Avatar: The Earth Kingdom.
The motions of the moon. Avatar: The Greatness of Grass.
But then the fourth one is going to be. Avatar: Trial by Fire.
Wait! How about this one? Avatar, the like something to do with the Way of Earth. Avatar, the Way of Fire. Nobody watches Last Airbender except me, right?
I do.
I was gonna say, I was hoping somebody would get the reference.
Right, dude. I was making that joke. You didn't get the joke. You didn't get what I was.
He said Earth Kingdom.
Yeah, and then Fire Kingdom.
The Fury of Fire.
Fury of Fire.
You didn't get that. Said Earth Kingdom in Trial by Fire.
Me who has never seen Avatar the Last Airbender.
You should watch Avatar the Last Airbender.
Oh, it's great.
I've heard it's great. I do want to watch it actually. But I have heard it's great. I heard great things about it though.
So. And then the fifth one, it'll just tie up and be like Avatar.
The Way of the Elements.
Yeah.
Honor. I shall restore my honor.
Legends of Kiri. Instead of Legend of Korra.
Yeah,
Please don't remind us of Legend of Korra.
But that show was terrible. That show was so bad.
The first season was fine, but the rest of the show sucked.
But seriously, though, I'm not the only one that still find it incredibly distracting, you know, hearing Sigourney Weaver, who is like, what, how old? Like in her 60s, 70s? And she's playing a teenager?
I will say.
It didn't bother me.
It didn't bother me a ton. Here's the thing. It was noticeable, but it wasn't distracting, if that makes sense. Like, I noticed that, like, when she's talking, it's like, yeah, it's like Sigourney Weaver, but up a few decibels. So it's like, okay, it's a little, like, weird, but it didn't, like, it wasn't distracting.
I think Kiri was probably my favorite character in the movie because I actually did like her. I liked her a lot. It's just the unfortunate thing is that I don't know where she comes from. Like, why is she connected to AWOL? Why?
The answer seems pretty obvious to me. I mean, dear God, she literally died connected to AWOL. So it's clearly to me that Awa got her pregnant, and she's the child of Grace.
Awa's a woman,
and Awa is what Awa is. I mean,
yeah, I mean,
Pandora has a vagina?
I mean, Awa isn't like
it's not like a male or female.
They're like it's their god. Gods are genderless.
Yes, I was gonna say. Yeah,
Awa. Okay, yeah, sure. The Renaissance showed God as a man, but it's God conform to gender? That doesn't.
Renaissance showed that God has a little.
But like the Tyrion literally says, "All mother, like please help us." Like, I mean, that should like. I mean, I'm just saying like that should signify that Awa's a woman.
Maybe they're just personifying it to like help them like understand it. Maybe.
And it's like So, how did you guys feel about Spider saving Korge?
I didn't like that.
I was looking at it, I'm like, don't fucking do it. Do not fucking do it. You fucking little shit. Yeah, just swim up. Just go. Just fucking swim. Have him die, please. For the love of God.
I think I'm the only one.
Why? He doesn't love you. Why are you doing this?
It doesn't, John, it doesn't matter. He's a kid. He wants his dad to love him. He wants his dad to love. He wants his dad.
He never wants.
That's a normal human impulse. I didn't like it either, but I understand it. He wants his dad to love him.
But then he's like,
ah, get away from me, and then fucking yeets
throughout that film. Throughout that film, he did not want his dad to like. He did not want a relationship with his dad at all.
But I mean, they developed some kind of relationship.
But like, at the end, I understand why he did it, because that even though it's not his actual father, so to speak, it is somewhat his dad. So like,
yeah.
Even you may have like the worst parent in the world. If you see them about to die, it's like you are kind of put at a crossroads. It's like, should I, or should I not?
If I like had the worst parent of the world, I'd let that fuck. Fuck that shit.
Fuck this fucking mirroring shit. Anyway, what Jay said. God damn it. I can't even.
Nah, fuck that shit.
But yeah, at the same time, it's like they should have kind of. They honestly should have killed them off, because like you literally had a perfect villain for the
next. Yeah, there you go, Mike. You got it.
Like they literally had a perfect villain, right there with the general, because like she was literally in the movie for like two scenes.
Yeah,
I kind of like this. I'm thinking of a core. I mean, Stephen Lane's a great actor. I like the fact that he wanted revenge.
But I don't like how Quidditch is going to be in like all of the movies.
Don't bother me. Stephen Lang's a hell of an actor. Stephen Lang's a good actor.
I mean, don't get me wrong.
Darth Vader was in all the movies. I mean,
I was gonna say what thing.
Darth Vader is more. I found Darth Vader is a lot more interesting than Quidditch.
You can't even be like, oh, Darth Vader is the villain for every single movie, for all the movies in the original trilogy, because the first one establishes Darth Vader. The second one we already know is Darth Vader, but it sets us up for a loop with the twist. And in the third movie, he isn't even the villain. It's Palpatine.
Yeah, it's Palpatine.
He is the villain. That makes him the villain, yes.
Yeah.
He's redeemed, but you can't be redeemed unless you are the villain.
Because what if all three of the movies?
Yes.
Because what if each of these like new movies will like establishes like maybe there are some like rebel Navi?
Who knows?
I mean, I was going to bring up before everybody was cutting me off. Thanks a lot. Like he's like in the other sequels, he's not the only villain, and like you said, Devin, a rebel Na'vi or something, maybe one that went rogue or something. They could team up and all. So
I was about to say that's a great point, Rob, because historically there have always been tribes who allied with the colonizers. There were those who allied with the Spanish against the Aztecs, namely those who were dominated by the Aztecs.
Yeah.
So, colonizers always take advantage of rivalries between tribes to play them off against each other. So, I mean, that's entirely possible. Go ahead, Jay.
I think it would have been a better story, because where I thought this was going to go, because when they all became avatars, I just thought that they were going to try to, like, you know, sneak their way into the tribe and, you know, try to blend in. And like, you know,
that would have been interesting.
And then when they least expect it,
they wouldn't have been able to. That would have been realistic, though. Because, like you said, nobody's going to believe that. Even Spider said, nobody's going to believe that. You speak like a 3-year-old. Nobody's, especially since they had the fucking tattoos on them and everything. Like, nobody's going to believe that.
Be like, oh, yeah, we were avatars, and we're like, we don't have a home. We want to learn your ways.
Yeah, they made the newer avatars, they made them a little too human, if that makes sense.
They made them kind of cartoony, I'm not going to lie.
They did, because...
Well, I mean, that makes sense, though, because they're not avatar. They're not really Na'vi. They're humans in an avatar body. So, I mean, it makes sense that they would be acting human. They're acting like soldiers. I mean, they're acting, of course, they're acting cartoonish. I mean, they're acting
like Jack. I will say, though, like Devin said, like I the scene where the son is like, hey, you want to see what my hand can do? Like, with the, like, that was fun. I saw it coming. I saw it coming, but the execution was still funny.
Yeah.
I mean, I understood where Sam Worthington's character was coming. I mean, I love the part where he's talking to his older son. He's like, what do the other guys look like? You know, he's getting on about fighting with the kids. He's like, what do the other guys look like? It's like, worse. He's like, good.
Yeah, but he chastised the second son, but with the old son, he's like, hey, good job.
Yeah, because like, he literally said that in front of annoyed
me. But I mean, he did. Look,
he literally said this in front of his second son. He said in front of his second son, stop covering for this knucklehead. I'm like, bro, what? Like, why are you, first of all, why are you getting mad at him? He defended his
son. Oh, come on. I mean, if you're upset he called his son a knucklehead, shit, I've been called fucker.
He defended his sister and he was chastised for it.
Yeah. That's not the point. The point is you're giving him, you're ragging on your son after you're the one that was saying, Sully, stick together. He literally is following what you're preaching, and yet you're the one that is getting mad at him. And then you're praising your oldest son.
He doesn't want his family. Where are they going to fucking go if they get kicked out of there?
I don't know. Another tribe, I guess. There's probably a ton of them.
Speaking of that tribe, we want to know what would have been interesting instead. How about other tribes not accepting Jake Sully as Taru? You want to know what? This is my pitch. This is what my pitch would have been for the sequel. Yes, Jake Sully is Taruk Mokto. He was the one that united all the nations together. But how about this? There are certain tribes that do not accept Jake Sully because he's not fully Navi. It literally could have been a plot point because the chief's wife was saying, "Oh, they're not even full Navi; they're half breed." That would have been a nice story. Have them not be accepted fully because they're half breeds, and then have them be
because they had to win.
No, it wasn't because it's not like, I mean, yes, it was something that was touched upon. They still had
to win their approval, though, especially hers.
Okay, but that had nothing to do with them being half breeds. It just had to do because it just had something to do because they're not one of them. They're not like the sea people. They can't, you know, they're not. They're forest people. It's forest.
That's fourth part of why they rejected her, though.
And Kate Winslet, how do you have a movie with Kate Winslet and she doesn't get that much time to shine?
I thought she did shine in the movie. What are you talking about?
Dude, she was barely in the movie.
What do you mean she was barely in the movie? She played a bigger role in it than Zoe Saldana did.
Because Zoe Saldana was the one that did the heavy lifting.
Well, yeah, she did most of the fighting, but I mean... she still shows she was a badass.
Again, when the Tiri was so underused.
Yeah, because she was.
I thought she was used appropriately when she was.
Because even though I don't like the first movie, she had a lot of badass moments. And I will give the first movie this. The scene I always liked from that movie was where it does make me smile. Is when she sees Jake's human form for the first time.
Yes, that was good.
I'm like, all right, you executed this scene very well.
Even though it's technically, you know, and another thing, it was something they could have done with a Tiri's character in this movie because she doesn't like Spider. She hates him. She thinks that he should be with his kind.
Yeah.
And then literally in the end of the movie, she did not hesitate. She was going to kill him.
Yeah.
To kill him. Why? And she was literally acting cold to Norm and Max, two people that were actually helpful towards them in the first movie, but she treats them like still like they're humans. Why? They could have done something where it was like, yes, even though some humans help, the Tiri still has a distrust for them after what happened in the first movie.
Yeah.
Because, like, I mean, and another thing, because, like, when Spider gets kidnapped, the Tiri didn't even bat an eye. Like, she just left him. She just didn't even, like, you know, hesitate. She's like, we have to go. Like, they just abandoned him without
even... Bye, bitch.
And honestly, if Spider betrayed them in that moment, I would not have been mad at it because they literally left him behind.
But Spider thought of himself as one of them, though. Spider thought of himself as one of them. I mean, clearly, it seems to me that Spider's going to be, honestly... I think they're going to redeem Quaritch at the end. I think they're going to redeem Quaritch.
But do you? But do you?
I'm thinking
enough with the redeeming, please. I think they're going to
redeem them, though. They're, I think they're either going to redeem Quaritch or have Spider turn on the Na'vi.
I think having Spider turn on the Na'vi would be interesting, but the thing is, he spent so much time with them, it would be very hard to believe for a relationship with a guy who fucking hates him.
Yeah, so like, it would come out of nowhere if that were the case.
I mean, your chance to have that happen is kind of too late.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's going to redeem his father.
We do not need another movie series where the villain is redeemed. Please, I'm sick of this. Please.
Yeah.
Just have an old-fashioned villain that just dies.
Yeah, because we don't know what he's going to do, though. He might try to redeem his father, fail, and then wind up killing him. Who knows? Mm. I mean, he might be only developing a relationship with him only to have him make the painful choice to kill him.
I swear, man, we live in an age now where like, oh no, villain doesn't have to be bad. Let's try to be friends with the villain because yay!
It hasn't even been done yet, Jay. What the hell are you talking about?
We live in a society after all.
We do live in a society.
Wanda, Doctor Strange did it.
Hmm. Dr. Strange did. She really realized she was the villain at the end and killed herself.
Oh, now she realized it?
She literally realized she was the villain. She realized, okay, yes.
That does not excuse all the bad things.
It didn't say it did. Of course it didn't. She died. That's why she died.
Died.
What the fuck?
Yeah, she died. Okay. Yeah, we totally think she's dead. Yep, now, she's dead.
Here's a question I have.
The fucking building crashed down on her, so I mean, I would assume so. Yeah.
So here's a question I have.
What?
So this movie has to make like what? Around like $2 billion or $1.7 billion?
It doesn't have to make $2 billion. It costs like what? But like $400 or $500.
It costs like somewhere between $300 and $400.
James Cameron said it has to make $1 billion.
It'll make $1 billion.
It will make $1 billion. It's
projected to make $500 million the first week.
You know, China's a big fan of this franchise.
China. But do you think it'll gross higher than the first one?
No,
I have my doubts for this.
The only thing I hope for is that it grosses higher than Endgame, so all the Marvel shills will bitch and complain. Exactly. I love seeing them complain. It's
get ready to watch. Actually, you know what? Get ready for James. James to say, "Oh no, Avatar 2 is grossing higher than the first one. I gotta release the first one again." 50 more minutes of bonus footage.
I will say this though, it is kind of impressive that if this does
up his own ass.
Yeah. It will be impressive that James Cameron has I think three movies in the top five highest grossing. Because isn't Titanic still in the top five?
Titanic is.
Oh god! Don't mention Titanic. Then Zach will start jacking off.
Exactly.
Why? Because of the rose scene?
Because Titanic is his favorite.
He loves Titanic. Yeah,
that's his favorite movie. Titanic is.
I was just looking at the comments.
Check out the comments. Titanic is still Cameron's best film. I said Titanic isn't even close to his best film.
I mean, I like Titanic.
Aliens.
I like it too, but it's still not even close to his best film. Yeah, I mean,
speaking of aliens, that, I said this to Devin.
Terminator 2.
Aliens.
I would take Terminator 2.
All those exist for crying out loud.
True Lies over Titanic
for crying out loud.
Speaking of Titanic, because I said this to Devin yesterday, so Devin knows what I'm going to say. But didn't any of you guys get Titanic vibes when the ship sank?
Yes, that's exactly what I was talking about in the chat. I'm like, I don't want to spoil it for you, but I just want to say he rips off a movie.
So no ship could ever sink or it's ripping off Titanic.
Hey, Titanic.
No,
like literally, Spider and Kiri are literally hanging on to the ship like it is a Titanic. It's even sticking in the water like it is a Titanic.
What the fuck?
And I'm thinking to myself like,
what a criticism. We just noticed it. It's clear that he's doing a Titanic thing. I mean, it's his own movie, so it's like, it's a water movie. Let's throw a Titanic reference in there. He knows how a ship sinks, John.
I mean, come on. I mean, that's how a ship sinks.
Okay, but it's how it sank. It's how it was shot. I mean, it's how the camera was filmed. Because I'm thinking to myself, like, is my mind playing tricks on me, or am I watching?
What, did it hit a fucking iceberg? What did I miss here?
So, Jay, sometimes you give yourself the creeps.
If anything, it capsized. The Titanic didn't capsize.
And I'm sorry, Titanic is not his best film. It's Terminator 2.
Agreed. Thank you! Thank you!
Agreed, yes. Terminator 2 is his best film.
Yes.
Oh, no, I'm sorry.
Or Aliens. I'm sorry. Terminator 2 and Aliens.
I'm sorry, I lied. It's not Terminator 2. It's Terminator Dark Fate.
He didn't direct that, so
that's on him.
Oh my god.
Billy didn't even direct that one. But still,
Phantom's on him anyway.
And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
What the fuck?
I was going to say, Jay, we don't speak of that movie unless you want to speak of with another show that angers you.
Yeah. I had to laugh when this guy took off his fucking headphones.
Gunshots are really loud and the dialogue isn't.
So this is sensitive ears. Wait, James Cameron didn't direct that movie?
I get it.
Wait, James Cameron didn't direct that movie?
No,
Tim Miller did.
I thought he had something to do with it, though.
He was a producer.
And he said the movie was good.
What?
James Cameron, didn't he say he thought the movie was
good? No, I just saw an article talking about the problem with it. He was talking about
how are you going to co-sign a movie that completely ruins...
Because, well, we don't know why.
But you know why? I'm thinking he did it for Linda Hamilton. You know that was his wife. Okay. It was also around the time they got divorced. I'm thinking that's why they got divorced.
Wait, what?
Yeah, they got divorced. He and Linda Hamilton got divorced.
Huh. Yeah. Cameron and Linda Hamilton were...
You didn't know
they
were married?
Him and Gail Ann Hurd were also together at some point.
Yeah, James Cameron fumbled
Linda Hamilton?
Guys, Rob has something to say.
Yeah. I don't mean to change the subject at all, but I want to address something that actually, because, I mean, you guys know in the chat, but... I was honestly going to see Avatar, this movie with Mark. I did see this movie with Mark last night. We were supposed to see it IMAX, and all I got to say is, fuck you, AMC, for fucking over the IMAX 3D.
Yeah, fuck you, AMC, because the projector blew out, and I couldn't see it in IMAX, so go fuck yourself.
Because here's what happened, is that I originally asked Mark, saying, hey, do you want to come down and watch it in IMAX 3D with me? He's like, yeah. Exactly. When tickets became available, there were no IMAX showings.
Exactly.
There were none. So I asked them, I said, what's going on? They just said, oh, yeah, we're upgrading our equipment. We're closing for construction. We're closing for construction. And then yesterday morning, out of nowhere, oh, yeah, IMAX tickets 3D are available now. Even though they told us it would be after Avatar 2.
What is going
that's,
on?
That's
hold on, Mark.
Thank you.
I got it somewhere.
What's going on?
What's going on?
What? No.
One of these days we'll have a clip.
Did you hear that?
Exactly.
Yeah, we got it.
What's going on? Here you go.
Imagine Mark Wahlberg at Avatar 3.
This is probably a terrible question, but was there a post-credit scene in Avatar 2?
No. He said he wasn't going to do that shit. He's like,
I'm not fucking staying a minute fucking longer. I already spent 3 hours and it got delayed.
My mind is hotwired to like think that there's a post-credit scene now and everything.
Yeah, so. I kind of want people who like kind of hate the Marvel movies just to have like for the people who do that, like just to have at the very end of the credits be like, this isn't a Marvel movie, you fucking assholes. Go fucking home.
Oh, you know what? Just have Jake Sully, Mark, can you full screen me?
What's that?
Full screen me. All right, so the movie ends with Jake Sully just walking out. He's got a bathrobe on. You're still here? It's over. Go home.
Yeah. Well, he obviously wouldn't be saying it in his British voice. You want to know something that I thought that
Sam Worthington was Australian.
Oh,
whatever.
Who knows? You want to know? You want to know what a missed opportunity that would have been nice if we have got it since? Because you know, we saw that Jake, you know, went into, you know, in the AWOL. It would have been nice if we actually saw his human body. I was kind of because we did see Grace, you know, in her human body, and then it changed to her avatar. Yeah. But I mean, I thought it would have been nice if we got to see, like, you know, Sam Worthington in his actual body if it was only for like 2 minutes.
You know what? The funny thing is when Colonel Quaritch saw his remains and picked up the skull, I'm like, he's gonna crush it. I was thinking
that was in the trailer.
Sure enough, he crushed it. Oh, I didn't.
And I whispered to my dad, I'm like, but the real question is, to be or not to be.
Not to be.
Yeah, I know. I was thinking of that too. Yeah.
Oh, he or
last two New York, I knew him well.
Guys,
last two New York, I knew him well.
Unfortunately, I have to skedaddle. So
All right. We're probably going to end it right here anyway.
Yeah, it's been real. It's been real. And before I leave, and I have to be quiet because there's people in the next room, you know. But we have to say it: She-Hulk, Rise of Skywalker, and Toy Story.
Which one?
Hey, I have my own now. Warner Brothers, James Gunn.
Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord.
For me, Taika Waititi.
Exactly.
Any horror filmmaker who doesn't understand shit.
this is your turn.
And yes, I have cast the whole of DC movies into the outer darkness of the 10th circle of hell, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. If you do not have teeth, teeth will be provided.
So I guess for me,
chainsaw.
Fuck.
I got one. Fuck Rob Zombie. Fuck Robert Zemeckis. Pinocchio!
Films, anyway.
For Pinocchio, man.
Fuck Rob Zombie's films.
But he made Back to the Future.
Yes, he did. But look how Grace has fallen, dude.
Yeah. I'm telling you, watch his.
I also love the hashtag bless thing you have in the background. That's very, very nice.
I'm in my guest room.
Okay.
But so, I will catch y'all later, Simone.
Later, man.
All right. Later, man.
See you later, man.
All right, so for me, fuck Rob Zombie's The Munsters,
mm-hmm.
And fuck any current ass rap musician. Musician.
Fuck Kanye West.
Oh, especially have fuck Kanye West.
Oh dear God, yeah. Christ, everybody has heard of Kanye West.
To tell you guys,
although surprisingly, he still has some defenders on. I will never
fuck. Yeah. Okay.
People defended right. Chris Brown. I mean, come on.
Okay. All right. Let's go in. In the.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess. Shit.
Even though we didn't love it as Mark did, you should still go and watch it just for the video.
Yeah. We'll see it.
If you have 3 hours to waste and $15 to waste, go see it.
Yeah.
Or if you can see movies for free, why do you have Regal Unlimited?
Or the AMC A-list.
AMC stuffs A-list, man. Devin, at least we don't have to deal with that Regal ad.
No, you have to deal with Nicole Kidman.
Hot break is good in a place like this. What the fuck does that even mean,
Mark?
What does that mean?
Did you enjoy watching the Nicole Kidman ad when we were watching Avatar 2?
No, I cannot.
No,
pretentious bitch. No,
but I mean,
I cannot stand that pretentious shit. Pardon me, I should not say bitch, but no, I cannot stand that pretentious shit. Yeah, I like Nicole Kidman as an actress, but that ad is pretentious as fuck.
Yes.
It's Hollywood jerking itself off, patting itself on the back. Aren't we so great?
Yeah, but it's not. But it's not Jesus stupid Christ. And cringeworthy like the Regal ad.
It's pretty cringeworthy.
I'd rather take the Regal ad. I'd rather take the Regal ad.
Yeah,
it's so awful.
I mean, we're pretty much saying pick your poison kind of deal.
It is.
I'll go with Nicole Kidman. At least Nicole Kidman one is funny, whereas the Regal ad makes me want to pull my hair out.
This is not my apartment.
Oh, wait a minute. I forgot. I don't have hair.
the Nicole Kidman one reminds me of George Clooney's Oscar acceptance speech, where he's like, "And you know what? Hollywood was there. You know when people were marching for Black rights, Hollywood was there. I'm proud to be part of progressive Hollywood." Dude, shut the fuck up. Hollywood has done far more to reinforce.
Yeah, we protect. Yeah, Hollywood, we protect rapists
with shit than anything.
And pedophiles.
Anyway, at the end of the day, my judgment is. Your mileage may vary. If you like the first one, you'll probably like this one. If you didn't like the last one, you probably won't like this one either. So,
as we've said like 10 million times throughout this review.
So what's the next one?
Let me have my moment, goddammit. I'm trying to make my thing.
All right.
Anyway. So
let's go and say what the next review is going to be.
It's going to be on Rome's channel, whether we like it or not. It's either going to be The Whale or I Want to Dance with Somebody, but who the fuck knows with The Whale? Yeah.
And then on the 30th, maybe if we have enough people, we're going to have our review of Babylon on my channel. Mm-hmm. So though it depends on if we have enough people or not. So.
Yeah. Yeah, yes, but remember, folks, that one's more of a maybe. But who knows?
Who knows?
Another 3-hour movie. Yeah.
If I want to watch like 3-hour movies, I'll watch the extended cuts of Lord of the Rings, or I'll watch Zack Snyder's Justice League.
Or Seven Samurai.
Yes. Speaking of which, anyway, so that's our show.
Yeah.
See you later.
Bye.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. We'll see you.
Bye. Later.